postherpetic, or you could also call it as pre-sinusoidal, sinusoidal, and post-sinusoidal. And of all the other causes of portal hypertension, cirrhosis is one of the most common cause. And other causes, as I said, extrahepatic. When you come to the extrahepatic, and we have sepsis, starting from umbilical sepsis, you could say, and some portal pyemia and unknown causes. Especially most of the unknown causes will be due to extrahepatic obstruction. And intrahepatic will be pre-sinusoidal. Very important example is schistosomiasis, not common here, more common in Gulf countries, and parenchymal cirrhosis of liver. That's a key important cause. Now, other causes I have just listed here, you could go through this list. You have extrahepatic, you have intrahepatic, and you have parenchymal causes. Now, coming to the picturesque depiction of the portal hypertension, as we have said, at all these junctions you can see what's happening in the liver, and you see a subsequent enlargement of the spleen, which is not displayed here, but you'll have from the right heart circulation and the hepatic blood flow, and how the hepatic blood flow increases in all the three conditions of pre, post, and hepatic cause of portal hypertension. Now, as I said, there will be an increased portal venous resistance, but this will always lead to gradual decrease in the flow of portal blood to the liver. So this is the most important thing. And as liver has to keep on functioning, there will be a lot of collaterals which will be formed, and this allows the portal blood to bypass the liver and enter directly into the systemic circulation. And as we said, we have a lot of sites which have been located anatomically. We have lower end of the esophagus, we have stomach, we have rectum, we have anterior abdominal wall, renal, lumbar, ovarian, as rare as ovarian, and testicular vasculature, where there will be collateral formation. Now, coming to the hallmark of portal hypertension is splenomegaly. As I said, we call it the cardinal manifestation, and not only a structural enlargement, it will also lead to a functional abnormality called as hypersplenism. And hemorrhage or bleeding from the gastroesophageal varices, then subsequent formations of ascites, acute and chronic hepatic encephalopathy, collateral vessels also result in capid medusae, which I had shown in the picture earlier, and also leads to a rare syndrome called as Creutzfeldt-Baumgarten syndrome. It's just a venous hum auscultated over those dilated tortuous veins on the anterior abdominal wall. Investigations for portal hypertension of any cause is going to be upper GI endoscopy most important. Barium swallow is not being done routinely nowadays because upper GI endoscopy, which is fiber optic, has taken over. And ultrasound is very essential non-invasive investigation to not only demonstrate splenomegaly, but also look at the portal vein size. And whenever the portal vein is more than 12 millimeter, you call it as portal hypertension. Portal venography and portal venous pressure are rarely needed nowadays. Let's move on to the complications produced by this increased portal pressure in a cirrhotic patient. It may lead to fatal massive bleeding from the varices and congestive hepatopathy or gastropathy, hypersplenism, ascites, renal failure, and hepatic encephalopathy. The treatment of portal hypertension, the treatment of the cause is very important, treatment of the complications as and when they arise, like example, hemorrhage or hepatic encephalopathy. And to reduce the portal venous pressure, people have some portosystemic shunt surgery, TIPS, you all know, transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic shunt, and usage of continuous and regular usage of oral medication, beta blockers like propranolol, which is very specific in this condition. Now, variceal bleeding, as I said, variceal bleeding keeps occurring whenever there is an increase in the portal pressure and sudden giveaway of that thin venous vessel wall. And usually these varices of the esophageal-gastric junction are located within 3 to 5 centimeters from the gastric varices. And the factors contributing to the bleeding, as I said, because not every varices will bleed to begin with, the degree of the portal hypertension, sizes of the varices to look at first, and the concomitant liver failure and drugs causing mucosal erosion, example NSAIDs, salicylates, etc. Now, coming to the clinical features, often this occurs without precipitating factors, the massive upper GI bleed, and usually presents with a painless bleeding. That's very important to remember. And clinical signs vary depending on the blood loss. So you can have a minimal signs of hypovolemia to hypovolemic shock. And endoscopy is the best approach to not only evaluate and also treat and rule out other causes of variceal bleeding. Now, management has become, this is a life-threatening emergency. You all have to know how to manage the variceal bleed. And once you have recognized that it's a variceal bleed, there should be a prompt estimation and vigorous replacement of the blood loss, like it's a volume loss. That's very important. And you need to also stop the bleeding by giving coagulation factors. That's very important, fresh frozen plasma. And patient has to be managed by a team in ICU with a close monitoring of all the parameters. Now, modalities to stop variceal bleeding, let's go through. There are local measures and measures to reduce the portal pressure itself. So now you have sclerotherapy, banding, essentially I've learnt about it, balloon tamponade and esophageal transection. Then how do we reduce the portal venous pressure? That can be done by giving octreotide or somatostatin, vasopressin or terlipressin as mentioned here. Then prevention of re-bleeding is very important. So you may subject the patient to sclerotherapy, TIPS, portosystemic shunt surgery and long-term oral propranolol intake. Sclerotherapy and banding, this as I said, it's most widely used initial treatment and can be undertaken at the same time as diagnostic endoscopy. And in fact, it stops almost 80% of the bleeds. Variceal bleeds can be stopped by these measures. And varices are injected with a sclerosing agent. That's very important. And band ligation is the next alternative to sclerotherapy. Then balloon tamponade is very important. Here they use the Sangsteken Blakemore tube. And that's a triple lumen tube. Or you could, currently we have a modification called as Minnesota, which is a four lumen tube. That also can be used. And we have specifications like air is injected into the gastric balloon and if required, esophageal balloon will then be inflated later. So when these inflated balloons are supposed to cause pressure, but make sure that they will not cause mucosal injury. And this pressure reduces the bleeding. And of course, we do have complications with these procedures like aspiration pneumonia and rupture of the esophagus. Now, medical therapy, very important. It's what you begin in the ICU or in the ward when the patient has collapsed. So intravenous infusion can be done of vasopressin, or like if vasopressin is contraindicated, then we need to use terlipressin. Earlier we used to use intravenous transdermal nitroglycerin and now we can use terlipressin also. Medical therapy, continuation of it, we know that we can use octreotide, we can also use somatostatin. Analog, we call it octreotide, and this is a potent vasoconstrictor for the splanchnic bed of vessels. So, and because of this, there will be a reduction immediately of the portal pressure, and thereby the bleeding stops, and very less side effects are there. And dosage of somatostatin is 250 micrograms bolus, followed by a constant infusion, and octreotide can be given at 50 to 100 mics per hour. Now, sclerotherapy, as I said, it's further explained here to you. And they will do a re-injection of this sclerotherapeutic agents at the site of the varices. So every 1 to 2 weeks, so that after 4 to 6 sessions like that, patients will have a very good control over the variceal bleed. And banding also can be done where varices are sucked into the endoscope and component of the endoscope, and allowing them to be occluded with a tighter rubber band. This is another procedure. It's more effective with lesser side effects as compared to the more side effects I have mentioned there on the slides or complications for sclerotherapy. You could see the varices there, esophageal varices. So this is the Sangsteken Blakemore tube which can be used in the medical wards with of course a resuscitation team around. And it could be an immediate measure even prior to having the upper GI endoscopy done on the patient who's having massive GI bleed. So this is a picturesque depiction of both the ligation and sclerotherapy. So you could see here, like this is a later version of